Thank you for the introduction. I will talk about detecting and analyzing solar panels in Switzerland using aerial imagery. I will also talk a little bit about Jupiter Hub, GPUs, and especially PyTorch. May I just ask, who of you already used PyTorch before? Oh, great. So I don't have to say too much about that. But I see half didn't yet have a chance. In Switzerland, we are not like in Germany. I think in Germany, Germany stops all nuclear power in 2022. In Switzerland, we need more time to think, find solutions. And there is energy strategy 2050. It's far ahead. And then we need a solution. And one part of that is thinking about solar panels. And one problem we have in Switzerland about solar panels is that we don't know how many solar panels are installed. I know this sounds a little bit crazy, but it's a federal state and we have different companies providing power. So some people know it, but there is no general solution. There is no data on how many solar panels are installed. At the University of Applied Sciences and Arts, Northwestern Switzerland, where I work, at the Institute of Geomatics Engineering, we started a project with the Swiss Federal Office of Energy. And the basic idea is to count the solar panels by using aerial imagery. We have a lot of data for that. For example, the Swiss Federal Office of Topography, Swiss Topo, creates aerial imagery of the whole country every 3 years. So every year we have a third of the country, and this dates back many years, so we also have a history of that data. So we could also count how many solar panels were installed 10 years ago, 20 years ago, and so on. And there is also a very interesting web service created by the Swiss Federal Office of Energy showing the solar potential of all buildings in Switzerland. I will show a screenshot in an instant. And now we just have the very easy task to detect solar panels. You see in the image, there are two types we have to detect. One is the thermal solar panel and the other one is the PV photovoltaics panel. So this web service I just talked about looks like that. You have every building in Switzerland. You can just click on it and you see here how much money you get a year. For example, here this building would be over 70,000 Swiss francs a year. This was, by the way, this was in Basel, where Europeisen was held, this building. Don't know those of you who were there. Who wasn't at Europeisen this year? Oh, I count two. Okay, so that would have been the volume. And we also have all different additional things there, like the inclination and so on from every building. Another data set is a 3D model. We have every building in Switzerland as a very simple 3D model, also created by Swiss Topo. So we have really the roof shapes, we have the roof overhangs, we have all facades, and of course the building footprint. So now let's look, so where is the solar panel? Yeah, did you detect it? Okay, we need longer than the algorithm for sure. There are not that many. I actually see here some. And you see here these things, that's chimney, I think, windows on the roof. You see, it's not that easy. Even for us humans, it's not that easy to detect and know what are solar panels. The Swiss image dataset of Swiss Topo, they just switched to 10 centimeter per pixel resolution. You see the above here is a 10 centimeter resolution, and here is the old one, the 25 centimeter. And in 2020, the first time all Switzerland will be in the 10 centimeter resolution. And you see here, if I ask again, where are solar panels? It's not, you have to really look and detect. And here, or you see maybe this one. No, this is not, this one is mean. And you will see the algorithm will have problems with that too. We also have near infrared, imagery. Also, that's new. We will have 10 centimeter per pixel resolution in 2020. Now we only have parts of Switzerland in that resolution, and usually it's still 25 centimeters. And in the mountains, we only have 25 centimeters. So only urban area, we have 10 centimeter. However, when we looked at the near-infrared pictures, we didn't really see a huge benefit when looking at solar panels, because windows and solar panels still look the same in near-infrared, so that's not really a valid solution. So let's summarize what we have and what we want. So we have the aerial imagery, partially in 10 centimeter resolution per pixel, and we have the RGB and near-infrared. We have lots of vector data, 3D data, of all roofs and buildings in Switzerland, and we know the roof size and the solar potential of every building. And what I didn't really say up to now, we have around 2 million buildings. So counting them manually would be lots of work. Actually, no one is even sure if it's 2 million, because some buildings, they are together, and it's difficult to actually get a number of that. So what we need is, we want the location of solar panels, we want the size of solar panels, and the type of the solar panel, if there is any on the 2 million roofs. What do we have on hardware? We have we recently bought HPE Apollo 6500. You can put 8 GPUs in that. We decided to have 4 GPUs inside. We have 192 GB of RAM. That should be enough. And 120 terabyte of fast storage. And of course, the GPU, four times, it's a V100 SXM2. And we will see more about that. And then, on the Apollo 6.5, we installed JupyterHub. Who of you knows JupyterHub? Okay, who of you knows, Google Colab? Okay, so it's pretty much the same, just it's on your own server. It looks like that. You start it. You can have JupyterLab on it. You sign in. I didn't really show that here. Username, password, login, and then you get something like that. It's just normal JupyterLab. You start your favorite kernel. You can add more kernels if you want. You could have kernel for every virtual environment, or even R if you like that. Markdown, JavaScript, whatever. Even C++ kernels if you really want that. And then here we started a Python notebook, and it looks like that. You can just execute your code. Of course, you have 192 GB of RAM and 4 nice GPUs. Okay, now let's look at PyTorch. This project was the first bigger project I used PyTorch. The reason for that was I just wanted to try PyTorch one time. There are some sites that say PyTorch is faster than framework XYZ. It's okay. you can put your numbers there. This is not the reason. I just wanted to try, give PyTorch a try. The main reason actually was, because tensors are more close to the GPU. So it's the whole GPU thing is easier to program in PyTorch, but this is also distributable. It's BSD license. It's based on Torch. Many people don't know Torch is a very old framework dating back to 2002, written in Lua script, and C++, and of course CUDA for the GPU part. And PyTorch was the Python version created in 2016, and it's mainly developed by the Facebook AI research group. The nice features of PyTorch are it's a really nice Pythonic interface. It doesn't really use NumPy. It uses its own tensors, but you can convert. There's a bridge in that tensor to NumPy or from NumPy. And I personally like the optimization module. For example, SGD is really it's really a nice interface. In a few lines of code, you can already start with your deep learning. And of course, there are lots of pre-trained models available inside. And I don't want to show too much source code. This is just to show, the SGD and the LR, learning rate scheduler, just two lines of code, basically. That's really nice. And you have lots of pre-trained models you can check. And of course, you can, yeah, I will show that later. What I wanted to use or we used was the Musk RCNN. Of course, you can use other frameworks to do that too. For those of you who don't know what's RCNN, it's an extension of the faster RCNN object detection algorithm, and it actually supports instance segmentation. So you don't just detect people. If there are several people here, every object has its own instance. So, if you want to use it, you just import the module. For example, models detection, fast RCNN, or the Musk RCNN, and that's all. I put a link. If you want to try it yourself, you can just go to the tutorial. It's a really, really simple interface, and you can create your stuff really quickly. So if you want to use your own, you want to extend your model, it's called fine-tuning, then you just write this code. It's actually, I will show you that later. Here, just to show the difference between image segmentation, instance segmentation, and panoptic segmentation, I made this screenshot just to show you if you have the same instance here in the image segmentation. In the instance segmentation, you have several objects from the same type. That's very important for labeling. I will show that that's something we did wrong the first time. Even up to now, I don't have the perfect solution how to label solar panels. That's not that easy. Believe me. What do you want to segment? For example, here on this image, we could make these sections plus this one separate, and then again this one, or you could do the whole, and here on the inside. That's not that easy. Labeling solar panels, we tried it several times, several approaches. It's really, really not easy. And we came up, we have to make as many segments as possible. So here is it, what it looks like. If we create the masks here and the labels, we really draw. Actually, it was Adrian. He's currently on holiday, so I have to give this talk. He will come back in March. He really earned long holiday after after labeling 2 days nonstop. It's really horrible. Every solar panel he labeled the polygons around it, and then after 2 days he gave up and went to holiday. He said, "I come back in March. Bye bye." No, he planned that longer. So what did we have? He did 2,600 labels with photovoltaic images. Unfortunately, only 200 labels of thermal panels and some things like windows and these things in a class other. But these labels are only on 214 different images. So of those, we used 80% for training and 20% for validation. And you see, the thermal labels or polygons are not that many because it's really hard to find them. We have 2 million buildings. Let's find thermal panels. That's really a big challenge. It's not that easy. So to add new datasets, we just use instance segmentation. We inherited the class TorchUtils data dataset. And there are many examples here. If you are interested, just click on this one. You get more infos there. What was really hard is supporting four GPUs. The reason for that is there are not that many examples in PyTorch how to use them. The documentation, they list it. They say you use Torch data parallel. This works, but it was a little bit tricky to really use 100% of every GPU. So that's what it looks like if you inherit the Torch utils data dataset. Actually, you need to implement a get item function or method which returns the images, masks, and the label masks. And that's just all. And if you do that, train the model, I can already come to the results. The first, you see, this looks promising. It detects the solar panels, you could think. And this is just a bounding box for the image segmentation. These are six different images here. We see it seems to work too. We see in this picture there are some thermal. The blue ones are thermal and the red ones are photovoltaic. So we really have the error. It's great, isn't it? However, it's not always that perfect. sometimes thermal and photovoltaic, they are mixed up. And sometimes some other stuff is detected, like here. You see here, this, whatever that is, some, from an elevator maybe, or airflow or something, I don't know. And here, this one is just a window. It's not a solar panel. But I have to explain that if I would make it bigger, even for us humans, it's sometimes hard to figure it out. I have some more examples where you have to think twice. Oh, is that a solar panel or is that a window? It's really sometimes really hard for us too. If we looked at the correct detections, we are at about 78% for the photovoltaic panels and only 47% for the thermal panels. But keep in mind, we don't have enough data at the moment. So it's not that bad, I think. I think we can do it better if we have more labels and if we do more labeling. So that's why we also implemented an online labeling tool. The idea was originally to have many people to participate, and the best would have been if I give the link today and say, oh, please, please label solar panels for us. You get some money. Yeah. And the problem is it's not easy, even for us. I think most of you would not see the difference between the thermal solar panels and the photovoltaic. So you need some instructions first. So you have to make a course, 2-4 hours, and see some examples, and then you can label, and it's not possible. We need some people who know that and who had in a smaller group. So, what we try to do, we're hiring 10 people for 1 week. We give them 1 day introduction. And then let's see what they do. So that's the best solution. Maybe you have a better solution, but that's the best solution we came up with. And then after this tutorial, what is what, they draw polygons 1 week. And then they go to holiday 6 months. So, but the real problem is not even the labeling itself. The problem is we have 2 million buildings, and which buildings actually do have something. So maybe they have to click 10 hours first to find one solar panel. No, not 10 hours, but you see the problem. We have to find it. But with the current model, maybe we can hit something. We can find a solar panel and then use this image to draw the real polygons around it. Maybe it works. But we still have to select random buildings too. Yeah, I will come to question later. So let me, I was fast. let me come to the conclusion. No, I still have some things. The first experience show that PyTorch can be used for this instant segmentation and solar panels. And it's unfortunately that the labeling is not that easy. And we need more images, that's clear, and especially for the thermal panels. And we will see more when these 10 people, we pay 20. Today I got an email, €20 1 hour. That's really good. That's really good. after 1 week, maybe we have better solution. But on the other hand, it's already looks very promising at the moment. And I'm quite sure that we will come to the 90%+. And then we can estimate how many solar panels there are and especially how much energy is provided by them. And I have a small announcement to do. I just finished this slide like half an hour ago. It's a conference announcement. I'm the organizer of GeoPython 2020, or actually all GeoPython since 2016. GeoPython is a conference. It's about geodata and Python. And next year it will be together with EuroSciPy in Bilbao. That's a big announcement. So it's official now. Just talked about it. Now it's really official. And I just created this webpage 40 minutes ago during the last talk, actually. Sorry. And you can sign up there if you are interested. And you can also follow on Twitter, GeoPythonConf. Thank you very much, and I have time for questions.
Actually, it's very good. We have 7 minutes for questions.
You mentioned this problem that people first need to find an image or a building where there potentially is a solar panel. I think there is a technique that could help you, and it's called active learning. Mm-hmm. Basically, you could ask your model, what are the problematic cases? So where does it have difficulties labeling your data? And only those instances you give to people to label. And basically, you can adjust your active learning strategy in a way that will benefit the model the most. So it's just a recommendation, not really a question.
Thank you very much for that. That's something we will do for sure. But I still worry that then we will not have all cases of thermal. So we do a little bit random too. So we combine it random and active learning. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you for an interesting talk. I had 2 questions. What's the input size of the images in the neural network?
It doesn't matter. You mean the size in pixels?
Yeah, that's right. The resolution.
I have to look it up. It's 1,000 by 1,000, I think, at the moment. But we tried it. It doesn't matter.
Okay, because I was thinking maybe if you do crops, and then maybe it would be easier to find the edge around the darker pixels. Maybe this is just a thought, and maybe you can mix it with like actual images of thermal and non-thermal panels, which are not on buildings even. I don't know if that's going to help. This is just ideas. But if you tried it, I mean, I couldn't tell. Second question is, what if you use thermal imaging? Couldn't that be or additional channels rather than just RGB? Wouldn't that be easier to, you know, identify panel from not panel?
Yeah, for the second question, yes, of course, if we had this data. The problem is, thermal images, they are not available for the whole country. And they would change even any time. And the second is, you don't have big resolutions in thermal imagery. We did some, actually Adrian, who is working at this project too, he did some deer detection and wild animal detection with that, and he used thermal imagery, and this worked quite well for that. But the solar panels are too small, I would say, smaller than a deer. And but we didn't try it because we don't have the data. We would have to fly with drones over the whole country, and that's not a solution. That's too time consuming and expensive. We can't fly around one country with a drone.
Thank you for the talk. My question is, do you think it's also possible to detect the orientation and tilt angles of the panels from the images?
You mean the orientation of the panels?
And the orientation and the tilt angle, yeah.
Tilt angle. For the photovoltaic panels, they are usually aligned to the roof, and we have the angle of the roof for every building. More or less, it's quite okay, the data. For the thermal, it's tricky. We didn't yet look at that, but it's an important thing. But it's really, really tricky getting the angle that we would have. We needed more data. We would have to go on every roof and collect this data manually. And I think that's not possible, creating this data set. But if we find enough people who want to climb roofs and measure, so you're free to do that.
Hi, you mentioned that you have the inclining of all the roofs. Do you use them for your labeling? So, for example, you could say on a north-facing roof, I'm sure it's a window and not a solar panel?
That's something we were thinking about. But the problem is it's not that easy, because sometimes it's not there are solar panels on flat roofs where this is not the case. So it's too difficult to actually take this into consideration.
Thank you for an interesting talk. Have you thought about using airborne laser scanner data? I'm thinking that if you're using full waveform data, you probably would have quite characteristic signals from the thermal panels and all solar panels.
The problem is that the resolution is not really that great, and we don't have the data set. That's a problem. Of course, it would be nice to have a countrywide data set of high resolution LiDAR data. Unfortunately, this doesn't exist at the moment, but Swiss Topo is creating one, but the resolution is not that great. And in 2023, this data set will be available, which is unfortunately past our project.
The initial question was, how many solar panels are there in Switzerland? Do you already have an estimate on the answer to that question?
No, not yet. It's too early. We are not that yet. We have to detect way over 90% correctly to make really an estimate. So at the moment, it would be, we could guess it somehow, but it would not be serious.
Thanks for this talk. Did you actually also think about trying not instance segmentation, but semantic segmentation with some additional measures then after that as a post-processing for using less data? It seems like the annotation is a problem here.
For solar panels, you're right. It doesn't really matter that much. We didn't do that yet, but it's thanks for the input. We can still think about that.
Hi, thanks for the talk. Do you think also about using data from the electricity net? Like in most of those installations should be registered somewhere.
We have some data, the problem in Switzerland, we have too many electricity companies. We have too many very small ones, and there is no single register containing all the panels. We were in contact with some, and we actually will probably get this information soon, but they are currently checking if they really can give it for privacy reasons. It's really difficult. Usually our experience so far is electric companies, they don't want to share any data, unfortunately.
Yes, also from my side, thanks for your talk here. How do you train your network, or what kind of loss do you have apply on your models?
I have to look it up. I can't tell you now. I have to look it up what the latest setting was.
One last question.
Hi, thanks for the talk. Did you have any idea about the performance evaluations?
I didn't quite.
Performance evaluations. Like how far and how accurate of the algorithm right now?
I didn't quite catch the last.
Like, did you pick up any metrics to evaluate your performance? And like what kind of failure is acceptable in this case?
Actually, we didn't think that far ahead. What is the final result? What we accept as failure? Of course, we want to be as accurate as possible. And because we need a number at the end, we need to know there are 500,000 solar panels installed, 500,224 solar panels installed. And we will never get the exact amount, of course, and we don't know yet what we want, the best solution, and we don't know yet how big the failure can be. We have to think about that. Of course, we need to be perfect. We would need 100% detection, and that's unfortunately never possible. But I think if we are in the range of 95%, then it's already okay.
Cool. Thank you so much, Martin. And now we have a little coffee break. Thank you so much for showing up as well. And
thank you.